Yeah. is called Metropolis.
Thank you. I'm going to count to six. Not yet. Six is my lucky number. Everyone stand up for it. You get a better diaphragm if you stand up for the count. So I'm going to count to six, and then it's got to be loud as hell, all right? Okay, take a big breath. One, two, three, four, five, six! I'm wasting my fucking time.
I think you should be louder than that, what do you think? Try it again, shall we? One, two, three, go!
It's not good enough. The people upstairs are not doing anything. Stand up, everyone upstairs, so we know you're real.
Everybody made a fucking noise then, and they show over the top.
Thank you.
another perfect day. But this it wasn't. This is your Rocket. We'll be right back. Black people play the blues. This is your Whole House Blues.
From Stoke, Mr. Lamy, kill Mr.
Thank you.
Christmas. We are Motorhead. And we play rock and roll.
Thank you. You were supposed to play in Paris last Sunday. So how did you get to know about the attacks?
I looked at the TV as it happened, and they were filming it, and you could still hear gunshots. Yeah. It's so dumb. Those people are so dumb. Yeah. What for? They think it's going to be a heroic thing, killing some people. You know. Assholes. Cowards, you know.
Did the thought come up in your mind that this could have happened at a Motorhead concert as
well? Yeah, sure, of course. I mean, we played the Bataclan many times, but 10 times, you know. It was a regular show for us in Paris. But thankfully, not that night.
And was it clear for you that you're not going to play that weekend?
Well, I didn't think they'd let us play. I mean, it was the day after, you know.
So the attack sort of came out of nowhere at that concert. Did that change anything for you? Would you go on stage now?
I would have gone on the day after. You know, if they stop you, then they win. And they're not going to beat me, you know, I mean, I do what I'm supposed to do. If the police cancel it, I can't do nothing about that. But we didn't cancel it, you know.
So you would have played and would continue playing?
Yeah, fuck those people, you know. They don't like rock and roll, and I don't like them.
You're right. But do you think we're more vulnerable now, or do you feel more vulnerable, something like that being able to happen?
We've always been vulnerable, you know. Every day you go out the house, you're vulnerable. You know, you're inches from diving under a bus, you know, or somebody hitting you over the head for your money, you know what I mean? There's nothing is safe. Everybody seems to be obsessed with safety, you know. Well, nothing's safe, okay? Nothing. Make the most of it while you're safe now. You won't be tomorrow, maybe.
So the French president is now talking about of war, and war is one of the themes also.
You've got to see his point. I mean, you just had Pearl Harbor in your capital city. You know. I mean, they declared war on him, not him on them.
But would you, I mean, you're one of your topics and themes in your lyrics is war as well. Would you describe this situation as war?
Well, it's difficult to think of another description, you know. A bunch of guys running around in a capital city with, you know, automatic weapons. Kill 137 people, what do you call it? You know, it's not exactly fraternity, equality, you know.
You also lost a former band member last week. Does that make you...
Yeah, he's the second one. First Wurzel and now Phil. Yeah, it knocks you back a bit. You know, I mean, I've known Phil, it feels like all my life, you know. It's not, but it felt like it. You know. He was a real character, you know, he was a real nutcase. And I do admire that in a person. But I think he lost the will to live, you know, because he was doing a lot of the wrong drugs and living with the wrong people, and it finally caught up.
Would you say you always used the right drugs?
No, but it's like, you know, it was too much for his constitution, you know. So far, I've survived it, because I invented it, more or less.
This is your 40th year with Motorhead. Did you ever think you would get this far?
No. You don't think like that when you're beginning a band, you know, you just want to play with some other guys and see what happens, you know. You look about a year into the future, that's about it. I mean, 40 years is a joke, yeah. It's ridiculous. I have no idea what I'm supposed to do now. Yeah.
Did you ever, if you knew it would go on that long, would you have stick to the name, or do you still would have chosen the name?
No, Motorhead's all right. It's a good name. All the best band names are one word. The Who is the best band name ever, I think.
When I was small, I always thought you were Scandinavian because of that letter.
Oh yeah, I was in Germany too.
Yeah. Didn't you just use it as a joke, or?
No, I used it because it looks mean. But there was a band before us, Bluestical, that used it too.
Because it looked mean?
Yeah, that Gothic writing looks mean, you know.
So many musicians mention you as a hero and as a role model. What is it you would say you started out doing differently than others?
Louder and faster, because we were the year before punk happened, you know. So a lot of people really didn't like us, you know, the press didn't like us. They gave us 6 months to live. So fuck them. They're all gone and I'm still here. Yeah, too bad.
How close do you feel to punk?
I liked a lot of the bands, but I didn't like a lot of them as well. The best were the Damned and the Pistols. I never liked the Clash particularly. I liked Joe Strummer in his previous band, the 101, he's playing vintage rock and roll, you know. But punk gave the music business a kick up the ass, you know, which he was really in need of at the time, you know. Very complacent. And now it's got another kick up the ass from the internet, because it cut its own throat by trying to bust everybody who downloaded. I mean, what is that? How could you bust everybody? Everybody would be in jail under the age of 15. You know what I mean? Stupid.
So you got the title Godfather of Heavy Metal?
Yeah, I didn't.
Do you feel yourself that way?
No, of course not. It's ridiculous. We're not heavy metal anyway. We're a rock and roll band. Yeah.
But even Metallica is calling you that.
Yeah, I know. Well, Lars came to see us when we played LA. I don't know what year it was, 82 or something. And he came along and he said he was the leader of our West Coast fan club. And he had Cliff, the bass player with him. And we found out later they were the only two in it. And he got really drunk and threw up down himself and went home, yeah.
The lyrics, you're writing them still?
Yeah.
Do you never get bored, or why do you take still new ideas?
Yeah, then I write about something else, you know. I mean, there's plenty of scope for our sort of sound. War, death, and thwarted love, you know. There's always going to be plenty of that with the human race being what it is. You know, we can't resist killing each other. And injustice is another big thing with my lyrics. And there's always been plenty of that.
How much Elvis and Little Richard would you say is in your music?
Oh, plenty, yeah. I mean, I used to have one of them hairstyles, you know, before my hair receded. Elvis was the one who showed us how to look, basically. I would say people like Carl Perkins, Little Richard, taught us how to sound. And the Beatles taught us we could write our own songs.
Do we hear your influence on others, in other music?
A little bit on early Metallica, yeah. There's a lot of, I mean, what do they call it? Brazil, Max. What do they call it? Sepultura was an early influence on them. But they don't stick with it, you know, they change. Because a lot of bands follow trends, you know, and it's fatal. Because you can't please all the people all the time. You know. We don't play for you. We play for us,
And if we like it, then we put it out. And if you like it as well, it's a bonus. But it's not necessary. Yeah.
But do you think you don't want to change your music also?
Is that I don't want to change it too much. It's doing quite well at the moment.
Someone said you told him that you knew the time before rock and roll.
Yeah, sure.
Which sounds crazy.
To you?
Yeah.
Not to me. I mean, I was born in 45, you know. So when rock and roll came out, I was 10, 11 years old, you know. And I knew immediately, you know. Because I saw this guy on TV, who was it? Billy Fury. There's all these chicks trying to tear his clothes off. And I thought, that's a job for me, you know.
2 years ago, I had tickets to a concert that was cancelled because of your health. How do you feel about being able to perform now and still?
Well, I'll do it as long as I can, you know. I mean, I'm 70 in December, so it's kind of ludicrous after that, I think. But I don't know, we'll see how I feel.
And I learned in another documentary that you actually moved out of your apartment that was so legendary, full of stuff.
Oh yeah, well I moved the stuff into another apartment. I got a condo at the end of the old street, so I threw out both places.
So you're fascinated by military memorabilia and uniforms. What is your position on war then in the end?
Well, war is stupid, you know. But as somebody once said, it's politics taken to its logical extreme. Yeah. I mean, they should put the leaders of the government concerned in a ring and let them fight to the death. And then, you know, the winner wins. It doesn't need 2 million people to die for it, you know. War's obscene, you know.
And I was told you changed your drinking habits from Coca-Cola, whiskey to orange.
Vodka and orange, yes.
How come?
Well, Coca-Cola is really bad here. And I'm diabetic, so I shouldn't even look at it, you know. But I carried on drinking it for 10 years after I got diabetic. But it was too much, you know, too much sugar.
A friend of mine who's a big fan of you too always has a big problem every Christmas to find people celebrating his birthday with him because his birthday is on Christmas Day.
Oh, yeah.
He said it must be worse for you even.
On Christmas Eve. It's Christmas Day here, right? Yeah. 24th. And even your own parents only give you one present for the two things, you know. Even your parents, you know, you'd think.
Did you ever regret not getting married?
No.
Can
I almost did a couple of times, but I never found a woman that could stop me looking at all the other women. So, I'm not going to be false, you know. I'm not going to get married and run around. I think if you get married, you should be fucking married, you know. That's a story. I could never do that.
Right.
Ah, that's good orange juice.
Is it good orange juice?
Oh, yeah. Almost perfect. Except for the orange taste.
Are you sometimes surprised, or do you find it surprising that you're still able to perform given the amount of drugs and alcohol you consumed in your life?
No, just lucky. Yeah, I don't really recommend the lifestyle because most people die of it. You know, I mean, a lot of my friends are dead, you know, who shouldn't be, you know, who had a lot more music in them, you know. But that's the way life is, luck of the draw, you know. It's all down to random, it's luck. It's not, you can't plan your life, it doesn't work. If you're confronted by a situation that you didn't plan for, and then you're lost, you know, baffled, you know. So you might as well be ready for anything. And to do that, you have to take all the drugs you possibly can, so as you'll know what they are.
Would you always continue performing? Or have you ever think...
After death, ever? No. I have to stop then, I think. But you never know, I could haunt somewhere.